And the blessing today. Father, we bless you. We magnify you. We give you the glory because you have been faithful in our lives. God, you're an awesome God in our lives. Look at all that you've done. God, you deliver us. You've taken away some hurt. Yes, taken away some pain. We may still be working on things, God, but we have to bless you and honor you for how far you brought us, oh God. You've been amazing to us throughout the years. Father, we bless you. We magnify you. Can you guys do me a favor? Open up your mouths right now and just begin to thank God. God, I thank you. God, I give you grace today. Father, you've been awesome. You've been wonderful in this house today. Set the atmosphere for the word of God right now. God, I bless you and invite you into my life right now. God, I know you inhabit the praises of your people. So God, I want the most out of your word right now. And I bless you and I worship you and I glorify you. Father, I give you all the glory. I give you all the praise. You're a gracious God. You're a wonderful God. You fed my family, Lord God. You paid my bills, Lord God. You put laughter in my heart. You got me out of trouble, Lord God. You gave me a spouse. You gave me some children, God. You gave me a good church, Lord God. You gave me a bright day. Father, I thank you. I give you praise. I glorify you right now. God, you made a way when there was no way. God, you went ahead and healed my body and picked me back up again. Father, you gave me use of my limbs. Father, I just bless you. I just worship you. I just magnify you. Somebody, come on, somebody. Just yes, look up to heaven and say, you're awesome, God.
Hallelujah.
Give before you ever get a chance to give. I give because God gave first. Amen. All right, let's go ahead and take a look at Luke 17 and verse 20. Luke 17 and 20. Some of these scriptures I just kind of pulled out from the first service, so I'm just going to share a couple things with you, and then we'll move on. Is that all right? All right. How many of you know the Word of God is the power of God to change your life? Let's just allow it to do that today. Let yourself be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Luke 17 and 20. And when he was demanded of the Pharisees when the kingdom of God should come, he answered them and said, "The kingdom of God comes not with observation. Neither shall they say, 'Lo, the kingdom is here,' or 'Lo, the kingdom is there.' The kingdom of God is within you." Amen. Put your hand on your chest right real quick, like this. And say, "The kingdom of God, is in me."
It's in me.
Say, "Jesus,
Jesus
is in me."
In me.
And the kingdom, is in Jesus. So just get it in your heart, get it in your mind, that I'm not looking out like this for Jesus. I'm not looking out like this for God. But God lives inside of me. And as you do, a couple of things will come to your mind real quick. Greater is he that's in me than he that's in the world. So understand that God has that. Y'all got, you guys have heard some of that, right? I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. It is him that worketh in me both to will and to do. Where is he working? In me, right? So we got a couple of these things. Just straighten up in your seat real quick and say, "I got a man living inside of me."
Man living inside of me.
Come on, some of you women are looking like, "I've been looking for a man all this time, and I got one living in me." Yes, you do. Say, "He's a powerful man." Come on, say, "He's a bad man."
He's a bad man,
but he can do bad, amazing things. Amen. So just get that. Get that in your heart that God is the God of the unseen realm. And he has already given you all things that pertain to life and godliness. And you are a citizen of two places. You're a citizen of the United States of America, probably, and you're also a citizen of the kingdom of God. Amen? And so as part of his kingdom, he rules, he dominates, he's the Lord of all things. Amen? So just get this in our heart and get this in our mind today, that we are not hoping or wishing when it comes to our faith. We believe, we receive when we pray. Can you say that right now? Say, "Whatever I've been desiring,
whatever I've been desiring,
whatever I'm hoping for,
whatever I'm hoping for,
I believe
that
I receive when I pray." All right, let's go on a little bit further because I'm just laying just a little bit here. Go to Psalms 24 and 1. Psalms 24 and 1. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Man, I tell you, I'm so excited. Glory to God. God's got your name in somebody's brain right now. God's got your life in the balance right now. He knows exactly what you've been believing God for. And I'm telling you right now, while you're sitting here in these chairs, God is speaking to somebody on your behalf. Ooh, why were you? You just missed an incredible opportunity to shout. That's all right, but you'll catch up with it in just a minute. The earth is the Lord. The terra firma, this actual earth, is the Lord's, all right? And the fullness thereof. Everything that's in it belongs to him, all right? The world, in other words, the world system. the 9th chapter. And let's take a look at the 38th verse. So here we are. We're believing God for something. We're here believing that God is able to bring a harvest to us. But sometimes we have to get some things broken down to us in our lives so that we can properly operate with it. I don't want to be operating on a revelation that allows me to receive and then leads you out of my love in a position where you're giving all the time, you're serving all the time, you're moving all the time, but you can't reap the harvest that God meant for you to have. I'm telling you right now, sometimes when we talk about our faith, we have to make sure that we cut Satan out of the middle of our faith so our faith isn't diminished and we're able to go ahead and receive what God always wanted us to receive. Amen?
Amen.
All right. Watch this. Pray ye therefore the Lord of the harvest. Who's the Lord of the harvest? God is the Lord of the harvest. Say, God.
Is
the Lord
of the harvest.
He's the Lord of all harvests, not just the harvest of souls, not just the harvest of money, but the harvest that you believe in God for, God is in charge of that harvest. You already said that everything you got belongs to God, and everything God has belongs to you, right? So God is in charge of all harvests. The earth is the Lord's and the fullness thereof. So there is no harvest that you can be asking for that's not belong to God. But watch this. Watch this. If you're going to have a harvest, what is that scripture telling you must do? It says you must pray. So that means that you have to ask God for your harvest. Bump your neighbor and say, make sure you ask him for your harvest. So when you pray from now on, I don't want you to be harvest-minded. I want you to be Lord of the harvest-minded. So for instance, if William wants my Lexus outside, he can go out and he can start looking at that Lexus. Ooh, Lexus, you're going to be a wonderful harvest. Hey, Lexus, that's a beautiful harvest. That's an outstanding harvest. But what he forgot is that I'm the Lord of the harvest. And if he doesn't ask, he may never receive that harvest. Why? Because he didn't ask the Lord of the harvest. So all he had to do was say, Pastor Calvin, can I have your Lexus? This is just an example.
Can I have your Lexus? All right.
But praise God, in my life, I've had the opportunity to give away 5 cars. So I just want to let you know that it's not so far-fetched what I'm preaching on, right? But the truth of the matter is if you ask of the Lord of the harvest, watch this, I have the ability to give to him. So when you pray, I want you to start being prayerful to the Lord of the harvest. Anybody believe in God for any kind of harvest in here today, right?
Amen.
So just lift your hands up right now and say, God, I'm asking you for my harvest.
For my harvest.
So happy to hear you say that because the Bible says faith is the substance of things you're hoping for. So whatever you're hoping for today, that is outstanding, right? So God is the Lord of the harvest, and he says, pray to the Lord of the harvest. But then we have a real problem right now because people's faith is dying and is growing cold because you receive all things that pertains to life and godliness. So you've been asking yourself, not because you wanted to, but because Satan's been messing with what you have. Look at your neighbor and say, how?
No.
Say, how is it going to get to me?
How is it going to get to me?
How is it going to manifest to me? Come on. How am I going to drive in the new Lexus? Yeah, how am I going to live in that house? Oh, y'all scared of him. Y'all scared of Pastor Calvin right now, huh? Because y'all looking like, oh my God, is he about to really tell me how? Yes! I'm about to really tell you how, because Satan has been diminishing your faith without any ability for you to take it from the unseen realm to the natural realm. But I just told you that God is the God of the unseen realm, but he's also the God of the seen realm. Watch this. He has unseen supernatural resources, but he also has natural resources. He gets specific with it at some point. He says the cattle on the 1,000-hill gold belong to me. The gold is mine. The silver is mine. Rubies and diamonds, they all belong to me. I am God, and I am the Lord of the harvest. Anybody got the audacity right now? Say, God, give me some souls to save.
Yes.
Come on, God, give me my whole family as a harvest. Let everyone in my family save the Lord. Anybody scared to do that right now? Watch this. I want your faith level to go on up a little bit higher. And I want to knock out the how forever in your life. Pastor Calvin's been operating in this revelation. And I want to make sure that the people of God in this place, they now know what to do when they're looking for manifestation. You guys know what manifestation is?
expectation is, we need to make sure. Watch this. I want to make sure you know what to do when you want it to show up. I want you to know what to do when you're asking God, who is in an unseen realm with unseen things. I want you to make sure you move him from an unseen realm to a seen realm, to a God who owns everything and everybody. Say, God owns everything and everybody. Because he owns the earth, what? The fullness thereof, the world, and they that dwell therein. Say, God is the Lord over them too. And watch what he tells you to do in this scripture. It's right here. This is how you receive what you've been believing God for right here. He says, pray ye therefore of the Lord of the harvest. Watch this. That he will send forth himself into the harvest. Doesn't say that, does it? What does it say? That he will send forth what?
Laborers.
Let me just give you an example. You won't like it, but I'm going to give it to you anyways. Imagine that I'm a slave master. And I own a plantation. Now, just because I got some slaves on the plantation, who owns the plantation? Who owns the harvest? The Lord of the harvest. And I am the Lord of the harvest. Now, watch this. These brothers and these sisters, they were working at the behest of the slave master. I just want to give it to you right now. Some of your minds is just floating all over the place right now. And I want to use this example because I want you to see that the slaves had no choice in bringing in this harvest. Why didn't they have no choice? I'm going to tell you why they didn't have no choice. Because they had a Lord that was a hard taskmaster. And they were making them do, watch this, not even what they were volunteering to do. Get this revelation with me right now. Say this right now. Say, God has the ability to turn people's hearts to bring my harvest. Oh, this is about to get real good if you can just wake your butt up and go ahead and listen. I got in trouble last week because I said what, so I decided I'd say what like 10 times today. But, thank you, what? Come on, somebody. We got to be more interested in deliverance of people than me being politically correct.
Right.
Amen. Come on, somebody. Wait a second. Be able to preach the grace of God in a way that people can understand and get a hold to it and relate to it. I can't be scared that y'all won't judge me because I'm not holy enough. It's not divine enough. Oh my God, really? Why don't I just live holy? Why do I gotta act holy? I just live moral and I don't have to act moral if I'm living moral, right? Why? You want me to be fake and then go out there and live crazy? No, I'm just gonna live consistently all the time so we can save everybody. I became all things so I can love everybody, so that some people can be saved. So go ahead and take your little religion. I said butt whooping, and I found out it was an African American woman that got mad that said, because I said butt whooping. I said, you show me an African American woman that's never said butt whooping, and I'll show you a saint.
Amen.
Okay. Cause every black body in here is just butt whooping at one time. I'm sorry, that's just a little bit digression. Somebody say laborers. People. Now listen to this. Unbelievers have a job in the kingdom of God. The Bible says that the wealth of the wicked is stored up for the righteous. So it is the wicked's absolute job to store up wealth to be transferred to your life. So when you're asking God for your harvest, really what you're supposed to be praying for is not for your harvest. You're actually asking for God to send people to come and bring your harvest.
Amen.
Come on right now for a second. Say, God,
God,
I need some help. And I need some people.
And I need some people.
So come on in. And bring my harvest. See, when I'm praying, my faith is not wondering how God's going to do it. God's got a billion people and a billion places and ways to bless me because I know that I'm just one person away from my harvest.
Right.
See, so when I pray for the Lord of the harvest, I'm not expecting God to get off his throne and come in and drop this on Darren Calvin. I'm just expecting God to speak to one of you guys.
Yeah. That's good.
Watch this. Or one of those heathens that I do taxes for.
Okay.
And bring me my harvest.
Amen.
Well, you guys might not be ready for this, but that's all right. That's
amen.
All right. Come on, one more time. Say, Lord of the harvest.
Lord of the harvest.
Come on, bless me with my harvest.
Bless me with my harvest.
Now, when you pray that, give God some glory for that. Amen. There is no greater joy than to see somebody that's been listening to the word of God, applying to the word of God, see it working for you. They take it for themselves and they make it work for them. So listen to the word of God. Watch this. We take up a lot of offerings, but I'm not taking up one right now unless you want to give one to me. Praise the Lord. Watch this. Somebody say, give.
Yeah.
And it shall be given unto me. Good measure. Pressed down.
Shaken together.
Running over. Shall God give it to my bosom? Does it say God?
No.
It says men.
It says who?
Men.
Oh, that's very interesting, isn't it? Because all of a sudden now, when we start talking about your harvest, there's got to be some people involved somewhere. There's a lot of different ways for God to work it through you. Him and working in me, both the will and to do. But there's still a man involved, me. So I want you to understand and recognize when it comes to harvest time, you can't hate people. I know you can be a bunch of haters in here. Raise your hand if you hate people. And I know people are troubled and I know they're bothered. But watch out for a minute. They're also the answer to your life right now. So when we give, it shall be given unto me. So I don't advertise and I don't market. When I go over there to that tax business and I ask those 800 customers to come in every year, I'm not asking God, hey God, I wonder where the money's going to come from. I don't have to wonder where the money's coming from. Somebody say, the money's coming from people. Come on, get the revelation with me right now. It's so glorious. It's so wonderful. It'll change your life forever. Say,
God
is sending me clients.
Sending me clients.
Say, God
is
sending me customers.
Sending me customers.
You see, all of a sudden, when you give, I don't need to market because I understand and recognize that God, the Lord of the harvest, is also the Lord over all that dwell therein, and they're bringing me a harvest. Raise your hand if you're looking for a spouse. Hey God, will you manifest a wife out of the heavens? Drop her out down the cloud like Wonder Woman and let her land right in my house. No, wait a minute. That's how Satan wants us to do our faith. That's how he wants us to pray our prayers. God, there's going to be a miracle that drops out of Adams, and Adams are going to form, and they're going to come. No. God has control over some things. God owns some things, and God has the ability to cause men to give unto my bosom. When I come in here, I expect men to give unto my bosom. You know what? I don't want to just expect unbelievers to give unto my bosom. I expect unbelievers to give unto my bosom. I got to go to Italy. I have to, because me and my wife had a man that just had to pay for us to go to Italy. Just had to pay. You say, well, that never happens. My wife still doesn't believe this shit. So you got to go ahead and believe this for a moment, right? You got to go ahead and let yourself step in. And I said, well, I don't know if I want to go. Well, God says, you prayed next to go, and this is your harvest. Watch this. Somebody say, I'm praying.
I'm praying.
And God's trying to bring you a harvest. But the problem is we won't follow an instruction that causes God to say, hey, go over there to that man, go over there to that woman, and bless that person with what I have told you to bless them with. Now watch this. I don't believe, if I'm pretty sure about it, that the God is taking us to Italy, I don't believe he knows Jesus as his Lord and Savior. But somebody say, God. You got to get this revelation to change your life. Reigns over the just.
Reigns over the just.
And the unjust.
And the unjust.
So I pray nice God for a harvest of souls. And today, let me just let you know right now, I don't know how they come about. I just know that God's speaking to me on my behalf. There's somebody with my name on their brain right now. As sure as I'm sitting here right now, I guarantee you that God is speaking to somebody on my behalf. Why? Because I put my seed in the ground and I expect the harvest. So I go to the Lord of the harvest. And when I go to the Lord of the harvest, I know, God, I need somebody with my airplane. I need somebody with my new church. God, I need somebody with my acreage. God, I need somebody with my new deacon. I need somebody with my new pastor.
People.
One more time, say people.
People.
Say God.
God.
Send people.
Send people.
Into my life.
Into my life.
Glory to God. So, number one, you don't need the absolute marketing plan. You need God to send people into your life. Look at Esther 6:1 with me. God can cause somebody to remember you. God can cause your name to enter someone's brain that hasn't thought about you for quite some time. Let me read Esther 6:1. Glory to God. Oh, that night, the king could not sleep. Lift one hand up to the Lord real quick right now and say, God, call somebody, not to sleep, on my behalf. Let me give you a little quick story about this, by the way. It was 3 o'clock in the morning, and Darren Calvin was praying for a wife, and Lynn Felice Calvin was praying for a wife, and at 3 o'clock in the morning, I couldn't sleep until I penned a 6-page letter. Why? Because the girl over in Los Angeles, who she hadn't talked to a guy in 2 years, had not had any contact with him, but this girl's over there praying and believing God for her husband. Somebody say, well. And over here, this man over here in Seattle is over here believing God for a wife. And God put some young lady's name on my brain that I hadn't thought about in a long time. If you believe in God for a spouse, real quick, say, God calls him not to sleep until he finds me. Ooh, that's some heavy stuff right there, y'all. Some of that just seems so far out of the realm of possibility. Oh, this is so much easier than in the 9 o'clock. I think the 9 o'clock service might have a little bit more faith in y'all. Oh, that night, the king could not sleep, and he commanded to bring forth the book of records of the Chronicles, and they read before the king. Look at verse 2. And it was found written that Mordecai had told of Bigathia and Teresh, two of the king's chamberlains and the keepers of the door, who sought to lay hand on King Ahasuerus. Look at verse 3. And the king said, what honor and dignity has been done to Mordecai for this? Then said the king's servants that ministered unto him, there has been nothing that's been done for this man. I got news for you right now. There is something that you have done in your past that people have forgotten you about. And I'm telling you right now, God is going to resurrect and stir it in their heart and their mind. And they're going to remember you. It might have been 10 years. It might have been 5 years. It might have been 2 years ago. There's a lady by the name of Janae McCann. Let me just let you know. I was the executive pastor up here in Everett. And I don't particularly remember ministering to her. I wasn't the pastor, so I wasn't doing a lot of preaching. All I know is that I knew of her, and she knew of me. Somebody say amen to that.
Amen.
But some kind of way, you guys, she got a hold to some news in her brain. And she looked up Life Change Church. So right now, my trouble, my spirit was so troubled that I couldn't sleep until I had to make a promise to God that I would follow through and do what God told me to do. Until I promised that I would bless that person, God would not let me rest. I'm telling you right now that God can move on somebody's spirit and cause their spirit to be troubled until they get ready to release what they have in their hands for you. Is anybody with faith in here today?
Yes.
I should say God is putting somebody's name. See, I just want to let you know that when it says give, it shall be given. Somebody in here might need to be the harvest for somebody else. Let me preach that other side of that to you, too. And he sent and called forth all the magicians of Egypt and all the wise men thereof. And Pharaoh told them his dream, but there was none that could interpret them unto Pharaoh. Look at verse 9. Then spake the chief butler unto Pharaoh, saying, I do remember my faults this day. Look at verse 12. And there was there with us a young man, a Hebrew servant, to the captain of the guard, and we told him, and he interpreted to us our dreams, to each man according to his dream he did interpret. Guys, I just wanted to get this in your spirit. I literally just want to pour this into your heart. The talents, the giftings, the skills that you operated in has the ability to bring someone into your future that you're not even thinking of. Has the ability to literally drop that thing. All he did was interpret dreams. And all you did was cut somebody's yard. And all you did was wash somebody's car. All you did was bake somebody's pie. Watch this. All you did is have a little bit of understanding and knowledge, and God was able to bring your harvest through somebody who would step up all of a sudden, and watch this, bring your promotion for a skill and talent that you thought went unnoticed and forgot. So somebody in here right now, say this to me, say promotion.
Promotion.
Comes from the Lord.
From the Lord.
Say, God
sends somebody.
To recognize
the
gifting and talent on my life.
The gifting and talent on my life.
And bring my promotion.
And bring my promotion.
Glory to God. I was sitting up in Everett about 10 years ago. So glorious. Defeated, brokenhearted, as sad as I could be. Didn't have any place to preach. Making $11.50 working at a sewing company. I was an attorney already, but I didn't have a job. Had no place to work, nothing to do. But all of a sudden, I'm sitting at my table, and I decide to start praying and talking to God. And I said, God, I sowed my seed, and I'm going to do my confession. In the middle of that confession, I became more discouraged than I could ever imagine. And so I looked towards my refrigerator, and I saw in my refrigerator that I'm going to preach to thousands, that I'm going to own a house that's 3,000 square feet, that I'm going to be a business owner. And all of a sudden, I looked at that, and I turned back towards my confession, and I allowed my faith to be in the Lord of the harvest. I allowed my faith to say, you know what? This is impossible. This could not happen. This cannot turn around. I don't have anything in my life right now that's going to cause this situation to turn around. I don't even have any possibilities for preaching, and I don't have any possibilities for a job. Anybody been there before? But all of a sudden, I just said, with men, this is impossible. Watch this. But with God, all things are possible. And watch this. Follow it up with this. All things are possible to them that believe. Now, when I say some stuff like that, y'all think, oh, that sounds real good, Pastor. Except for I know how to make it happen. And you know. You know how I make it happen? The same way every single time. Hey, God, I need some help. God, send somebody to call me on my phone. God, send somebody to knock on my door. Boom, all of a sudden, a knock hit the door. In comes a man by the name of Clee Martin. He walks in and he says, hey, you know what? It was Saturday night. Hey, we took 8 board members up to Canada, and I can't lie to you, sir. We have been looking and inspecting and looking at your background. And when he walked in at the door, but I'm going to cause you to come up, and you're going to be in charge of the whole staff. Nobody will be over you except for the pastor. That day, he gave me that position. Now watch this. As soon as I got ready to walk out, the phone rang, and it was a guy by the name of Dave Morris. Dave Morris gives me a call up. It was an amazing thing. He says, you know what? I'm going to go ahead, and I'm going to accept your offer. I don't know why. I'm taking your offer above everyone. Let me just tell you, God took me from making about $15,000, $16,000 a year to making $150,000 in less than 3 hours.
Amen.
And the answer is always the same. God, I'm in a position, I'm in a situation. I'm not just hoping for no pie in the sky situation. God, lead me to the place where you bring somebody in my life. I need a new person that is in a position to bless me. And I'm telling you right now, it may look like this, it be impossible. There's no way you're going to get blessed. But the truth of the matter is you would stop for a moment and see your harvest and start saying, God, I thank you for that person with my promotion. God, I've been interviewing, I've been looking for a job, I've been sending out my resume, and nobody will call me back. But God, I know you're faithful, and I know you're able, so God, go ahead and put my name and my resume on their mind, and all of a sudden your harvest will have an opportunity to show up. Now watch this. God can call someone who's in a position to bless you. Don't ever forget that there's promotion that's available in your life. Number five, God can cause someone to come and sow into you because they've heard about what the Lord has done in your life. Look at 1 Kings 10 and 7. 1 Kings 10 and 7. And he said to the king, it was a true report that I heard in my own land of the acts of your wisdom. Howbeit, I believed not your words until I came, and my eyes had seen it, and behold, the half was not told me. The wisdom and prosperity exceeded the fame which I had heard. Verse 10, and she gave the king 120 talents of gold, of spices, very great store, and precious stones. And there came no so much more abundance of spices as these which the king of Sheba gave to King Solomon. Now, I just want you to think about this for a minute when we start thinking about this message that I'm preaching to you today. Do you know that she just gave King Solomon $1 billion? Researchers have looked at it. That was $1 billion. Anybody believe to be a billionaire? Well, you better hear me right now. Let me just let you know you will work as hard as you can all the days of your life. And your hard work will never make it happen in your life. It's going to have to take the grace of God in your life. Before this revelation, we were laboring real hard trying to make things happen. But then all of a sudden, we lifted up our hands and we started saying some crazy things that I want you to hear. God, I thank you that you give me cities, which I didn't. Houses full of good things, which I didn't fill. Cisterns dug, which I did not dig. Vineyards and olive trees planted, which I did not plant. That means that we have two people in here. Those that want to try the world's way and work as hard as you can. Go work three jobs if you want to, because you're a smart, bad man, and you think you can bring it to pass on your life. And those who will just say, Say this out loud. Say, I
am
making money.
And making money.
While I'm sitting here.
While I'm sitting here.
You heard Greg Barrett say he got one word from the Lord, right? And now men are going to have to come and bring you money. God just did the same thing for us this year. Your business is about to turn around here right now. Your commission work is about to turn around right now. Your promotion on your job is about to turn around right now. Your loneliness is about to turn around right now here today. Because all of a sudden now you're recognizing how the harvest was supposed to get to your life. So no longer when you pray will you have to doubt whether or not it's going to happen. You know beyond a shadow of a doubt that God's got a million people available to hear his voice and be able to turn it around in your life. Go ahead and stand to your feet today. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Glory to God. Oh, God, I thank you today for your word. Father, I thank you that all over this place now, the faith, the hope, faith is the substance of things hoped for and the evidence of things not seen. Father, I thank you that all over this place right now, people are wore out, tired, trying to make things happen on their own. God, people are wore out, tired of believing you with no expectation that it'll ever be done. You see, unless you have faith and expectation, things can never happen in your life. Today, Pastor Calvin is giving you an understanding of this one thing, that your expectation should always be on the Lord of the harvest. And he's got people all over this planet that he's connected to, heathens and non-heathens. And he's ready now to speak on their behalf. And in this place right now, before you move out of this place, I would ask God to start moving on your behalf. God, right now, start sending people of harvest in our lives right now. In Jesus' name. Cause my future spouse to hear my name now, God. In Jesus' name. God, cause my future boss to be sent my way now. In Jesus' name. God, cause my partner that I have not met. Cause them to come into my life right now. In Jesus' name. God, cause the person that will open ministry doors to come into my life and open up those doors for me now. In Jesus' name. God, there's people who my children will need. Send the person, send the teacher, God. Send the divine connection right now. Divinely ordered connections all over this house for our children. Have doors open to them that no man can shut. Now listen to me. There's people all over this place that have received opportunities at the hand of people that you can't explain and you can't know why they opened up those doors for you. But now this faith that I'm giving you allows for unlimited possibilities. Unlimited resources are now available to you in your hands because God has a heathen queen of Sheba that's ready to knock your doors down. There may only be a few of you that's ready to operate in that kind of faith. I understand it. I recognize it. Some of you are still caught up with, oh, well, that's nice, Pastor, but what am I going to do? Well, I just told you right now that God is faithful. God is strong. He's got people in a position to bless you. All over this house and all over this place, allow your faith for the next 2 or 3 minutes just to go up a little bit higher. Father, all over this place, there's people who would like to be in homes and houses. Father, I pray that they would find favor with someone in a position to bless. Last week, Lord God, you sent a partner to me. Send them partners, Lord God, to allow them to own homes that they would have never qualified. Father, I thank you. You sent me new people in my life, Lord God, that have anointings on their life to go with the anointing that's on my life. Father, I pray now in Jesus' name that you would bring those people into my life now. In Jesus' name. Turn our whole circumstance and situation around. There's some pastor out there that's crying out for deliverance. They're looking for a church that comes in, Lord God, comes in and merges with them and is a part of them. And Father, I pray that someone that's in a position
with that church, to be a blessing to Life Change Church, would come into our lives right now. In Jesus' name. Father, there's somebody with an apartment building in this city who has no need for it anymore. His children don't want it, Lord God, or they have no children. Father, I pray that you move on their heart and give that apartment building to Life Change Church now. In Jesus' name. Father, I thank you and give you praise that there's editors, Lord God, and graphic artists all over the city, and they can't find anywhere to try to develop their skills. And I pray that you put the name of Life Change Church on their heart and bring a man into this building. Father, I thank you and give you praise, Lord God, for your goodness and your mercy, Lord God, that you put upon our lives through the lens and the guise of judges, prosecutors, Lord God, that have our files before them. Father, I pray that you would speak to them on our behalf and cause the sentence, cause the results of it to be lighter. Stretch your hands towards me right there. Divine appointments. Divine appointments. Divine appointments. Come on, take yourself out the equation. God, you're the Lord of the harvest. Send laborers in the harvest. I said move yourself out the equation. Take yourself off your labor. Get it off of how smart you are. Get it out of your realm of you doing it yourself. And just lift your hands up in humility and say, God, I need some help. Oh, I'm gonna give you an understanding on how things work for just God. He has the answer in the form of a person. Because people are always your problem, but people are always your answer. So all over this place today, begin to receive your answer in the form of people right now. If you're a business owner right now, stretch your hands towards me. Father, in the name of Jesus, put their name out there on the hearts and minds of their current customers. Cause their current customers to have conversations today about this particular individual, about this man, Lord God, about this woman, Lord God. Let the conversation lead to additional relationships, God, and cause those relationships to blossom into more business now. In Jesus' mighty name. You see, it's God, guys. It's God right now. Father, I pray right now in Jesus' name, Lord God, the business opportunity that somebody's been waiting for. I pray that you open up doors before them that no man can shut, Lord God. Give them favor for their bid to be the one that receives the approval.
Yes, Lord.
The offer that people are making on their homes right now, let the favor and grace of God be with the owner, and let their blessing, Lord God, come forth through those people now.
Yes.
In Jesus' name.
Yes, Lord.
Father, we just give you all the glory. We give you all the honor, Lord God. We give you all the praise. In Jesus' name. Come on, give the Lord a great big hand. Guys, I want you to look at me for a minute. I received this word. And this word wasn't for you initially. This word was for me. Because God had to get more productivity out of my life. So I took a chance that you might be able to receive this word today. Because at some point you're going to recognize that what you have is not enough. And that God, in his faith, wants to take you up a little bit higher. All right? So I want you to go ahead now, and I want you to dial on in to the limitations upon your own self. Let God take those limits all the way off. Bring in everything that he wants to bless, right? Somebody say this out your mouth. Say, dear God, I thank you for your word.
For your word.
Say, I thank you for your son Jesus.
Thank you for your son Jesus.
That came and died on the cross for me. Say, I believe that he lived.
I believe
that for me, Jesus died. Say, I believe on the third day. God rose him from the dead. Say, dear Jesus, come into my heart. Be my Lord and Savior.
Be my Lord and Savior.
Say, I receive you now.
I receive you now.
Thank you for saving my life.
Thank you
for saving my life.
All over this place now, give the Lord a great big hand praise.
That was me. I accepted him for the first time today. Glory to God.
someone else that made that confession and believed God for the first time in here today? Anybody else? Glory to God. Well, praise God. God bless you, God. We'll get to it.